Hi, welcome to Understanding Gradle. In a previous video, we looked at the test task and explored how Gradle starts several JVM processes to do work in parallel. This time, we will explore the compile task, which is, next to the test task, the task that's running most of the time in your builds when you do Java development. Similar to the test task, the compile task often needs much processor resources and is often memory heavy. So parallel execution and controlling the memory consumption is a topic here as well. It works similar, but also a bit different than the test task. Because another important aspect for the compile task is controlling the Java version for which you compile your code. And because Gradle runs on Java itself, there can be a relationship between the JVM you use to run Gradle and the Java version against which you compile your code. Let's take a look. You may remember from my video about test tasks that there are essentially three types of JVM processes Gradle may create. The first is a client process, which starts up when you call the Gradle command. The second is a Gradle daemon that does all the work of initializing and configuring a build. It survives several build sessions so that it may cache things in memory. Depending on a task implementation, a task is either directly executed inside the daemon, or Gradle forks additional worker JVMs that do the actual task execution work. We learned that the test task always forks such additional processes to run the tests. The compile task works a bit different. Here you can configure if you want Gradle to run the Java compilation inside the Gradle daemon, or if you want it to fork an additional worker JVM to run the compilation. Running inside the daemon is the default setup. If you configure nothing on the Java extensions or on the compile task directly, that's where compilation will take place. Then there are different situations, which we'll explore in a bit, that will make Gradle fork a worker JVM to compile the Java code. Compared to the test task, only one worker JVM is forked because compilation in one project and one source set can't be done in parallel. But the worker JVM can be used by several compile tasks. So similar to the main Gradle daemon, this is a worker daemon process that stays alive during the build and can do the compilation work for several compile tasks, which means the compilation for different projects or for different source sets like main and test within one project. You can still achieve parallel compilation by allowing Gradle to run compilation tasks in parallel. That means if source set or projects do not depend on each other, their compilation could be done in parallel. In such a case, several worker daemon JVMs may be started in parallel. If compilation is performed inside the daemon, this will be done in several threads in the daemon JVM. In both of these cases, Gradle uses the so-called Java Compiler API to start the Java compiler, which is a Java API that's part of the JDK, which you can call within a Java process to compile Java code. Another option to compile Java code, which you may all know about if you ever compiled code from the command line, is calling the Java C tool that also comes with the JDK. So a third option to run the compile task is to let it call the Java C tool or another Java compiler tool like the Eclipse Java compiler. In this case, the task is configured directly to use the tool, which means that Gradle will give control to the external tool to compile the code. So in this case, a separate process, which is not necessarily a JVM, is started, but it's not under Gradle's control. Gradle will simply wait for the process to finish. So in this case, the processes can't be reused by multiple compile tasks. This is usually the most inefficient method to compile code, so you should only use it as a last resort if you need to use a special compiler. For the other two methods, it's usually fine to stick with the default for smaller projects. For larger projects, where compilation time becomes an issue, often forcing Gradle to fork compiler daemon JVMs is the better option because it gives you more control over memory and other JVM settings, similar to what you have for test execution. And there are also cases where you need to use worker JVMs. This is when you want to compile with a Java version that is not the Java version you are running Gradle with. Because if the compilation runs inside the Gradle daemon, it uses the Java compiler API of the JVM the daemon is running with, so for example Java 11. If you now want to compile for Java 19, for example, which Java 11 doesn't support because it doesn't know about it, Gradle can fork worker daemons using Java 19 and then compile against it. Note that this is often a misunderstanding. Usually when a new Java version comes out, something in the current Gradle release breaks with it, because Gradle so deeply interacts with bytecode and so on. But this doesn't mean that you can't compile against the new Java version. You just have to keep using the older version to run Gradle and with that the Gradle daemon. Then, for the compile worker daemons, a different Java version can be used. So let's see how you configure Java compilations to make use of the different options we just explored. As mentioned, if you just apply the Java plugins and configure nothing, Gradle compiles code inside the Gradle daemon process using the compiler API of the JVM the daemon is running with, which is the JVM you started Gradle with, usually identified by the Java home environment variable. If you run the build with info logging, Gradle tells you that it uses a certain Java toolchain which points at the JDK we are running with. It also says that it uses the Java compiler API for compilation. As these messages indicate, Gradle uses the term Java toolchain to identify a JDK that is used when working with Java code, which is for compilation, but also testing or Java doc generation. Recently, Gradle introduced this as an explicit concept, and there's a feature in Gradle Core that keeps track of the JDKs, so the Java toolchains you have installed and which are therefore available for compilation and testing and so on. Gradle hereby is able to detect installations automatically and even download new JDKs for you. I'll link the documentation on toolchains for more detail on how you can control this. In the Java extension, you can configure the details of the toolchain you want to use. Gradle then matches this with the toolchain registry and tries to find a suiting toolchain. Here we say that we want to use Java 11. By coincidence, we are running Gradle with Java 11. And the first toolchain Gradle looks at is the one it is running with. So if it matches, which is here the case, Gradle will do the compilation inside the Gradle daemon. Now if we change this, for example, to Java 19 and run the compilation again, we'll see in the logs that Gradle started a worker compiler daemon, but is still using the compiler API. If we want to force Gradle to always use a worker compiler daemon, we can do this by setting the fork option to true. Similar to what we did for test execution, we can now control JVM arguments like the max memory. This becomes interesting if you have a large code base and a ton of dependencies. Then the compiler might need a lot of memory to load all the class files of the dependencies. If you run into this, I would recommend to always fork a compiler worker daemon. Then you can control the memory here, and it does not influence the memory usage of the daemon. This might also be high already to managing all the dependencies and so on that are loaded. By doing the forking here, you can detangle the memory requirements a bit here. I'll show you how to change the memory settings for the daemon JVM in a bit. For completeness, let's look at the other two options you can set here when you fork a process, which is either the Java home directory or directly the Java executable. Both options lead to the third case where Gradle uses an external tool to do the compilation. As mentioned, I would not recommend doing this if not absolutely needed. In large builds, this will decrease compile performance a lot, because there are new compiler tool processes started all the time. If you want to do this anyway, you explicitly have to reset the toolchain settings, because these two settings are in conflict and you can only use one of them. A few more notes. A Java compiler, let's say the Java 19 compiler, can also compile for older Java versions by using the release setting. This is something the Gradle toolchain registry does not take into consideration. If you say you want a certain toolchain, Gradle will always choose exactly that Java version. If you still want to use a new Java version and compile for an older one, you can set the release flag here. Or for older versions that do not support the release flag yet, the target and source compatibility. But usually, if you rely on the toolchain feature, you won't need this. Furthermore, these are settings you often want to do for all compile tasks in a project. So not just the compile Java task for the main source set, but also the compile test Java task for the test source set, and any other compiled Java task that you might have if you add additional source sets and feature variants. But since there is no way to configure these details in the Java extensions and you have to do it in the task directly, you could use the configure each method for all compiled tasks. I'm usually a bit careful for recommending using this way to configuring tasks because it will configure all the tasks of a certain type that you add at any point during the build configuration. But in this case, doing it like this makes sense. Now there are two things left that we still have to look at. First, we need to explore how to configure the memory for the Gradle daemon process itself if you want to stick with compiling the code inside the Gradle daemon process but run into memory issues. The second is, how can we make Gradle do compilation in parallel? Both of these things are very fundamental settings about which Gradle needs to know right at startup, because, for instance, JVM arguments like the memory can't be changed once the daemon JVM has been started. That's why these things can't be configured inside the build scripts or the settings file, because these are not even loaded at the moment these settings are needed. So for these, there's another file we haven't yet talked about, which is the Gradle properties file that you can put in the root folder of your project next to your settings Gradle KTS or settings Gradle file. Now, in many projects, I've seen the Gradle properties file also being used for other things, like for custom properties. I would always recommend not to do that. Put all your custom details into your convention plugins. And if you want to have them in a separate file, make a file up yourself and read it in the convention plugins. I would leave the Gradle properties file only for details you need to tune the build itself, and then also commit the Gradle properties file to version control so that all machines on which the build runs have the same settings. For example, the same memory settings. And these settings are configured by the org Gradle JVM args properties. So these are the JVM args for the Gradle daemon process. I would recommend to set them in every larger build. If your build is too large and the Gradle daemon runs into memory issues, you can increase the memory here. Furthermore, you can use this to set properties that are usually system dependent to a fix so that you get reproducible builds no matter if you run on Unix or Windows machines. One example of this is the file encoding. Now to recap the JVM argument setup, you set all the JVM arguments for the Gradle daemon process, so the main process of a Gradle build if you will here, and you set JVM arguments of worker JVM processes, which tasks like the test task or the compile task start in the task configuration directly in your convention plugins. The last thing is parallel compilation, or in general running tasks in parallel. As mentioned, the compile task itself cannot do anything in parallel. But if you have a large build with many projects and source sets, several compile tasks that do not depend on each other can run in parallel. This means that Gradle will run tasks from different subprojects or different builds that do not depend on each other in parallel if the task graph allows it. Traditionally, this option is not turned on because the Gradle API allows you to access the state or the configuration of a task of a certain project from another project. This is something you shouldn't do, and you won't if you follow the convention plugin approach I promoted in all my videos. So unless you have a legacy build with a lot of intertangled configurations that no one understands anymore, you can safely turn this on and always should turn it on. It usually significantly speeds up the build of large projects. A setting related to this, which I mentioned in the video about test tasks, is the max worker property. This tells Gradle how much parallelism is allowed in general, which includes parallel task execution and worker processes that run in parallel. By default, this number is derived from the available resources, so the number of CPU cores available on the machine the build is running. So you usually don't have to change it. But you may use it, for example, on a local machine if you want to do other work parallel to running a Gradle build, which can eat up almost all resources on the machine if this option is not changed. In these ad hoc cases, you can also set it via command line using the max workers command line option. So for the Gradle properties file in general, a good recommendation is to have it under source control with at least the JVM args entry, the parallel entry, and also the build cache entry, which I mentioned in my video about tasks. I'll talk more about caching in one of the next videos. This was an overview about the compile task and how it relates to the different JVM processes Gradle is using and starting. One last thing to note is that the compile task works incremental, which means if the task is not up to date, but you have a previous compilation result, Gradle inspects the previous result and the class path to decide which classes need to be recompiled and which not, and passes this information to the compiler. The incremental compilation works with all the three different options to call a Java compiler that we have seen. It's always enabled unless you explicitly turn it off in the tasks options. What we have seen in the video can give you some tools to speed up compilation if you feel it's too slow in your project. If you are unsure if memory consumption is an issue and if you should change memory settings, you can analyze the JVM processes Gradle runs, which you've learned about in this video, with tools like JProfiler to see how much memory they are consuming and experiment with different values. If you still want to optimize compilation further, you have to see that you can reduce the compile class path of your projects. I plan to do a video about dependency analysis where I will also touch on this topic. If you don't want to miss any of this future content, please subscribe to this channel. See you next time.